We're here in the cockpit with the boat on its side, and I'm going to be using a bevel gauge to measure the angle between the side of the trunk and the bottom of the cockpit. But my bevel gauge, if you notice, this wheel actually sticks out past the bevel line. If I try to put a thing there, you can see there's a gap at the bottom. So that's kind of stupid. So what I've had to do until I have time to modify this is when I use it, I put a block up like that so that I'm not actually measuring at the very bottom. And so I'll try to capture that angle. Tighten it up a little bit. So this is the angle I'm going to be using to set my flush trim bit on my router. Okay, as you saw, I've just already drilled a hole here into the centerboard trunk, and I actually do not recommend this, and Graham pointed out that he always drills a hole in the bottom of the boat on either end of the centerboard trunk before he glues the trunk down. That way he doesn't have to go through the stress of finding this hole, because if you miss, you'll be gouging into your trunk, which is already nicely sealed. So I had to do this, but I would recommend drilling a hole before you glue the trunk down. Okay, I have set up the trim router with my tilt base, and I've matched that angle to the angle we measured inside there. And I'm going to set the depth of cut to be 3/8 of an inch, not more than, because there's really no need to cut any deeper than that. Except that we don't want our roller to be hitting any squashed out epoxy, so I will go a little bit deeper. If we do end up hitting some squeezed out epoxy, it'll just bump over it and we'll have to come back in with a slightly deeper cut. So I'll probably set it at about 1/2 inch on that side. And just double check that you're got it held properly. So that's my angle, and my trunk is at this angle, and I'm going to start widening this hole and making sure that my cut is properly angled. Okay, you can see I've done just a small sample, and just feeling in there, you probably can't see it too well, but the bottom looks perfect. It's just barely cutting into the camera will focus. It's just barely cutting into the joint, and on the top I can feel I haven't quite made it because I'm bumping into some squeezed out epoxy. So I'm going to continue widening out this hole, and then I'll show you the finished product. Alright, we've made quite a mess here, and here is my finished trunk, and let's see if I can get this to focus. You can see it's cut flush with the inside of the trunk. This slightly white area is where the bit went into the epoxy and took off the gloss layer. So it's not through the epoxy, but it is into the first layer. Now right here, I do have a streak here where I have gone into the wood and I've cut totally through my protective barrier, and so I will need to seal that back up. You can see the 3/8 bottom here and the quarter bottom there. That's where the joint is. Looking down the rest of the trunk, it feels pretty good. I'll just hit it with some sandpaper and the ends are nicely rounded, and I did go into the wood a little bit right there, so that'll have to be sealed up. It could also be a little bit of fiberglass on here. I've got enough gap in my center board that I can fill that, and just looking at the top side, it'll be hard to see on camera, but it looks like I haven't gone in anywhere over there, so that looks good. And just for curiosity, let's check, let's get our center board and see what kind of a gap we have in the trunk. I haven't drilled the pivot pin yet, so I can't actually pivot the board, but it's gonna do something like this. And I can feel the top of the board hitting the stop. The top of the trunk cap limits the travel of the center board, so it can't go more than that. And closed, it's up against that. So here's the board, and I'd say we've got about an inch of play. And by the time we put a tiny little plastic shim in there, we'll be good to go. You can see the, you can kind of see the board up in there. This amount of play is not a big deal, in my opinion. Because when you're sailing, the board is always pinned up against the side of the trunk, and it's always better to leave a little extra gap in anything dealing with boats. Tight tolerances are the enemy, because they will eventually tighten up to the point where things jam, and you don't want this board to jam. You always want it to come up reliably. So I think we've got it just about perfect. Okay, if you're wondering, I will go ahead and mic this for you just so you know what I'm actually dealing with here. And here's our board before paint. I am going to be painting this board. 1.134, 1.13, 1.12, let's check it over here. 1.132, 1.126, or about 1.13, or just over 1 1/8. And the trunk is 1.238, 1.24, 1.28, 1.26, so the trunk is just slightly over 1.24. The trunk is almost exactly 1 1/4, and the board is almost exactly 1 1/8, maybe just a hair over. So we've got about a 1/16 on either side, and that's the play in this trunk. Okay, I've got the boat upside down now. I ended up adding a 4x4 spacer to the legs underneath, and that was to get the tabernacle off the ground. And if you look underneath, we've got foam supporting the cabin seat tops, front, forward, and aft, so that we don't scratch the paint. Okay, here's the gear chine viewed from the outside, and the first thing we need to do is flatten off all these teeth. And the best tool for this is a block plane, because you can just get in there and chew each one off. But I don't have a block plane, I just have my number 4 Stanley plane. So I'm gonna be using that to knock the teeth off of the gears. And what you want to avoid is gouging into the panels themselves when you're holding it flat to knock the edge of the chine off. And so the way you do that is by adjusting the angle of the blade with this angle slider. And what that does is it shifts the blade from left to right. You can see that I'm getting a larger gap on the left side, and now I'm getting a larger gap on the right side. And what that's doing is it's pulling the blade back on one side and forward on the other side. So over here it's not cutting, or cutting less than over here. And so if I have my blade set like that, I can run the plane over here and avoid gouging the side of the hull. Another method is to use your block plane to plane off all the top gears, and then use a flush trim bit to knock off all the sides. It's a lot harder to plane this way than it is to plane top down. The only issue with this method is you can't do it up near the bow where the angle is extreme, and you have to constantly be adjusting the base of the tilt router. So you can keep the base a little bit slack so that you can adjust it with some pressure, and that way you can make tiny corrections in between each teeth. So that's how I'm going to finish this one off. So we've knocked off all the teeth. You can see a little bit of a line left by the router using that method if you don't have the angle exactly perfect, but that's okay because we're going to be putting a nice radius on this chine anyway. So I'm going to go ahead and do the other side, and then I'll show you how we do the radius. Okay, we're ready to shape our chines, and here's the chine, and the idea here is going to be to shape the chine one step at a time. The first step is going to be to plane a chamfer on the end of the chine. That's a little bit exaggerated, but we're going to use the plane to plane a chamfer all the way down the chine. Here's our chine. And once we get that chamfer nice and even all the way down the chine, we are going to then take another chamfer off the rest, a nice even chamfer all the way down, and then we may take a couple passes just on the corners of those chamfers. The idea here is to turn a square corner into a rounded corner by taking progressive chamfers and then finishing with sandpaper. There's no way that you can accurately round this chine here, and then there, and then there, and then there, all the way around, all the way down, and have it be even. It's impossible. So we're going to take a full chamfered pass, and then take another full chamfered pass, and I'm probably going to go about 3/4 of an inch wide on the first chamfer pass and see what that looks like. This angle here is about like that, and so a 3/4 inch chamfer should be pretty good. So we're gonna give that a shot and we'll see what it looks like. So when we do this, we're gonna be running the plane down the chine, and the angles of the hull you know, it changes as you go down the length. So you want to try to bisect the angle of the chine with the plane. You don't want to be here all the, you don't want to hold the angle of the plane steady all the way around. You're going to have to bisect the plane with the chine a little bit as you go. And one way you can do that is to hold the plane and then just hold your hands on either side of the plane and feel the two surfaces and bisect them as you go down the chine. We're going to be doing continuous passes. We're not going to be doing a lot of starting and stopping. They're starting to get kind of wide up here, so I don't really want to go a whole lot more here. See, this is already 3/4. I put a little gouge in there. There's no way you're not going to be able to prevent all gouges, so I won't go as far as that anymore. I'll start bringing my stop point closer here. Okay, I'm pretty happy with that first chamfer. It's about 3/4 inch wide. A little bit narrow there, so I might take a couple short passes right there. And here where the angle starts to get really obtuse, you can see from this angle, it doesn't take a lot to get the radius up in the forward sections because there's not a lot of angle change between the bottom panel and the side panel. But back here near the stern, it's much closer to 90 degrees. It takes a lot more passes to get a 3/4 inch chamfer. Okay, so that kind of showed up. So what you can see here is that this is the original chamfer. This is the second chamfer and the third chamfer that I've put on the outsides of those. If I run my finger over this, it's really starting to feel like a nice even round over. You can see a couple little waves and bumps, and you want to remember to try to hold the plane in line with the radius. A couple of times I was getting off at an angle, but you want to try to keep it in line with the radius because you're relying on the butt of the plane to keep your cut fair and fair out any high spots. And so I'm gonna just probably take a couple more passes, but this is pretty close to done. You can kind of see it farther up there. It's really starting to be a radius, and it's not gonna take a whole lot more. In fact, I could probably finish it off with just 80 grit sandpaper from this point.